everyone. It's 6:02 p.m., and I'll call this regular board meeting of the Goose Creek Consolidated Board of Trustees to order. Ms. Brott-Timms, was this meeting properly posted?
Yes, it was.
And do we have a quorum?
Yes, we do.
And for the record, we have 5 members present and 2 absent. Opening exercises are Dr. Bullinger.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Klim, school board members, and Dr. O'Brien. We will begin the June 26th board meeting tonight with a prayer led by Mr. Klim. Everyone, please rise for the prayer and remain standing for the pledges, who will be led by Mr. Campisi.
Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day and the time we have together as a group. We ask that you lead and guide and direct us through this process as we make very important decisions that will shape the future of our school district. I also ask that you give everybody the blessing of safe travel as they head to their homes when we disperse tonight. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Everyone with face flag, place your right hand over your heart and recite with me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now the Texas Pledge.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you. You may be seated. Mr. Klim, I'll turn it back over to you.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Bullinger. You do not win the trophy tonight. We will now move to item 3 on the agenda, which is a public hearing regarding the proposed budget and tax rate. So we'll ask Ms. Clark and her team to join us.
For the record and for this hearing purposes, we'll let each of you introduce yourselves to the to our audience.
Good evening, President Klim, board members, and Dr. O'Brien. I am Bridget Clark, and I am the Chief Financial Officer.
Good afternoon. I'm Leanna Dixon, Director of Finance.
I'm Matt Bullinger. I'm the Assistant Superintendent of Human Resources.
And I'm Brooke Dockery, the Associate Director for Compensation.
Okay, with that, thank you for joining us, distinguished guests as well. This evening is where we actually have our public hearing for the budget adoption process. This is a culmination of all the work that we've done all year and the many presentations that we have brought to you throughout this process beginning in early January. And there should be nothing new. It is all repetition. So anything that you see this evening is something that you have already seen before. So with that, we will jump in. And for a brief compensation overview, I will turn it over to Dr. Bullinger.
Okay, good evening. So as Ms. Clark stated, this is the compensation package that was presented previously. It includes a one-time bonus that's equivalent of a 2% increase. It'll be, again, a one-time bonus, so it won't apply like a general across-the-board raise. Thank you. Which is approximately $1,300 for teachers. Of course, that may go up or down depending on their years of experience. And so that's the first piece of this. The bonus does apply for all full-time employees who are active. Secondly, as we were presenting in previous superintendent's reports, there was a question about how our teachers fell below the median for our more veteran teachers, especially around 15 years and older. And so equity adjustments were added on top of the one-time bonus to account for that. So starting at year 6 up through year 31, but especially through year 25, equity adjustments had been made, and that allows our veteran staff salaries to be more competitive. And so that's the second piece of the compensation plan highlight. And then last, we just wanted to restate that the teacher's starting salary will remain at $61,250. Step adjustments have been included. They were not previously included, but when we talked to our TASB consultant, we included those. And so what that means is that we wanted to make sure that if a third-year teacher will now go into their fourth year of teaching, they will follow that step ladder of our salary scale. And so that's also been included in the compensation package. I'll make sure I covered everything. One other piece we wanted to make sure we emphasized, even though it's up here, is that the one-time bonus is applied for all employees who are hired on or before the last board meeting on June 5th, whenever the compensation plan was approved. For our teachers who are hired after this, of course, they will go on to the pay scale. If those equity adjustments apply, they will receive that. Also, they receive a $1,000 sign-on bonus for our new teaching staff.
Did anyone have any questions on that slide before we move on to the budget?
Just a quick comment. I think everything you explained about the step was our intention anyway. We just didn't articulate it as well as you just did.
All right, thank you. So this is the legally adopted budget that you are charged with hopefully adopting this evening, and there will be a standalone action item in regards to this. The three legally adopted budgets are the general fund budget, the school nutrition budget, and the debt service budget. You see there the general fund, as we've been discussing for the last few months. We're going to have the $21.859 million revenue under expenditures, $249 million revenue, and $271 million approximately expenditures. Gives us that deficit that we've been talking about as we employ the glide method moving forward. Then you see the school nutrition budget. You see here we also have a deficit budget. This was a planned deficit because we are required to spend down that fund balance. We have too much in reserves. That's a great problem to have, but nonetheless, the Texas Department of Agriculture requires that we spend those funds down, and we are making capital expenditures and purchases along those lines to reinvest in the child nutrition program as we spend those funds down. And then the debt service fund, you see here there's a slight surplus there as well. But again, these are based on values that are not certified yet. So once the certified values come in, these numbers will be shored up a little bit more. But the way the legislature has played out this year, and we're in special session right now, and we don't know what's going to happen with tax compression, we erred on the side of caution. And we left our tax rates alone, except for the slight decrease in the maximum compressed rate. And so that's why you're seeing a slight surplus here right now. But we do expect there to be, some tax compression, possibly. We just don't know, because the Senate and the House can't come to an agreement on that. But when we do our legal posting, which is required 10 days prior to the adoption of the budget, you can whatever tax rate you legally post, when you actually adopt the tax rate, which will be late September, early October, you can decrease it from that legal posting, but you cannot increase it. So we erred on the side of caution and left the tax rates equivalent, and you'll see that in a later slide here we'll cover briefly as well. But this is actually what you're going to be adopting tonight, is this actual slide and these budgets here. Are there any questions on this thus far? Okay, and then this is just for completeness. This is the 2024 capital projects budget, and you see we're showing a balanced budget here with estimated revenues coming in at 4.4 and equivalent expenditures at 4.4 as well. All right, so the preliminary values that we received we have experienced an increase, but again, these are very preliminary, and last year these numbers swung widely because we had a lot of activity in the warehousing areas in Chambers County, and then HCAT had some significant swings because of the increases in property values that we were experiencing last year. But we're leveling out now, and we're getting right around to the 5.5% increase, which is, getting more close to historical increases year over year for property values. But again, very preliminary. We won't have the certified values in the case of HCAD maybe, August 31st. Usually we get chambers on the 7/25 date. So over the next couple of months, we should have those values, and then we'll be able to see what our true increases are year over year and be able to subsequently prepare our tax rate. Speaking of tax rates, then you see here we left the MNO tax rate basically stable. We just brought it down to the original maximum compressed rate reduction that's put in place by TEA. We know that reduction is going to be more than this, but so this is going to be the highest we could expect our tax rate to be adopted at, barring any very hopefully unlikely legislation that comes our way. But you will probably see these numbers come down if what we think is going to get passed in tax compression is probably going to come down. But at this point, we're just holding it stable because we only have preliminary values and do not have certified values yet. All right. And as I said, we're at the home stretch here, and we are expecting to adopt a tax rate hopefully by early October at the latest once we get our certified values. So with that, I will turn it over for any questions.
And since this is a public hearing, we can take questions specifically regarding this budget process and adoption if anyone has anything. Yes, sir.
Well, it would, depending on what is approved by, or what is recommended and approved by the voters, it would conceivably increase the tax rate for the INS rate, of course. And depending on what our certified values end up being, that could mean a little bit more or a little bit less in a tax rate. So if we get more certified values than what we were anticipating once the values are certified, that would bring the tax rate down. As a function of, calculating what the capacity is that the voters approve. So if the voters approve, a couple of hundred million, or if they approve 500 million, that's going to play into what the tax rate would increase.
And in simpler terms, and correct me if I'm wrong, usually on a bond election, we'll ask for 8 to 10 cents, but we don't increase the tax all that much at once, if at all. In the 2019 bond, we've only done how much? Because whatever I say will be wrong. We asked for a dime, and we've only used how much of it?
We our tax rate right now is 32.5 cents, but we had originally shared with the voters it was going to be 37.5 cents. So
right.
We're down a nickel.
We've used a nickel of what the voters approved, and we try to keep that as low as possible.
Right.
Anything else? All right, board members? All right, thank you very much, guys. We appreciate your time.
Thank you.
All right, let's switch speeches. All right, now we are at citizens' participation, which is the time the board will hear public concerns or public comments from those who have properly signed up to address the board. At regular meetings, the board shall omit public comment regardless of whether the topic is on the agenda posted or not. At all other board meetings, it will be limited to things on the posted agenda. Each speaker is reminded that he or she is limited in his or her presentation to a maximum of three minutes, and that he or she should respect confidentiality concerns and refrain from attacking the personal character of any individual. Pursuant to state law and board policy BE Legal, the board cannot consider take action on concerns at this meeting unless they pertain to an item on the posted agenda for this meeting. Any deliberation or decision on an item that is not posted for consideration at this meeting shall be limited to a proposal placed on the subject of the agenda of a future meeting. We have one speaker signed up tonight, and that's Ms. Kim Kostick. And Ms. Barat-Timms, do you have a timer handy?
Yes.
All right. Ms. Barat-Timms will be your timer tonight, and she'll give you the 1 minute warning and call time when your time is up. And one moment.
Yeah.
You tell her when.
Okay, there it goes. All right. Good evening, President Klim, members of the board, Dr. O'Brien. I come before you today again to address the Anti-Bullying Committee and discuss the last presentation that you received on it. If you're not paying close attention, you may have missed that the administration did not discuss the final two slides in the superintendent's report. Of all my years of attending public meetings, this is the first time that I have ever experienced a complete report not being shared. What makes this so disheartening is that those two slides were the primary focus of my address that I included with the attachments that I gave to you at the May 22nd meeting. Not only were those two slides not addressed, two more were added that were not included in the posted agenda. Coincidentally, the subject of these slides were ahead of my concerns that I addressed to administration about the roundtables. Plain and simple, you were given a gross misrepresentation of what was discussed in those roundtables. I do not appreciate witnessing our board being given misleading reports by our leadership when asked direct questions. For example, a member of this board asked if all students were given the same questions during those roundtables. The truth is that they were not. On two occasions, I have been confronted and accused of by members of administration of my concerns being personal. I assure you that my concerns are with the process, and if there is anything that makes this personal, it would be that I do not want other families to experience what mine has. Every question that the board asks are great questions, and they are ones that I believe that the anti-bullying committee should be charged with answering. How do we ensure that it is getting reported? The full process is followed, resources are provided, the list goes on. I'm not saying that we have done nothing, and what I am saying is that what you asked to be done is not being done. And now they want to dissolve this committee that is not being fulfilled with what we all understood that you charged them to do. The law requires that the campus
One
level
minute.
Committees, and I get that probably more than anybody else in this room. It is necessary, it is a necessity and required by law for the district level committees, and it's not required by law for the campus, for the campus committees. It is required for the district committee. It is not required, but it would ensure that there is compliance and provided direction and hold the campuses accountable. It was your directive that was intended for these campus committees to be subcommittees of our district level. Dr. O'Brien, you are correct. This is not a solution that we can create a system and for it to be able to go away. Yet there are systems that can help, and transparent and being accountable is one of them. There may not be grievances about bullying reported to the district, but there has been discontent and grievances that have been brought to each of you. And just because they may not be tagged as that doesn't mean they don't exist. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kostick. Our next item on the agenda is approval of the June 5th, 2023 regular board meeting minutes. I need a motion, please.
I move to approve the minutes.
Second.
I have a motion from Mr. Campisi and a second from Mrs. Barat-Timms to approve the June 5th meeting minutes as presented. Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Seeing 5-4, 0 against and 2 absent, that motion passes. We will now move to superintendent's reports. Dr. O'Brien.
Yes, our first superintendent's report this evening will be by our director of maintenance and our assistant superintendent of operations, Anthony Price, Mike Rasmussen, and I believe the team members from ABM will be coming up. You may all remember ABM assisted the school district with a project to reduce maintenance costs, and you'll hear about that a little bit tonight. A few years back, we were, I understand, the largest project in North America, having 9 campuses or 9 fields being turfed simultaneously. So that's a lot to do all at one time, but we got it done, and very proud of this team. Thank you all for being here this evening to talk a little bit more about the annual report.
And I want to personally thank you for being here, and I put you on the agenda at very short notice, so I appreciate you accommodating.
Thank you. Good evening, President Kim, board members, Superintendent O'Brien. I'm Anthony Price, Assistant Superintendent of Operations Services. I have with me tonight Michael Rasmussen, Director of Maintenance. I have Brian Walker for ABM AV Solutions, and Jamie Dyson, ABM Infrastructure. As Dr. O'Brien said, on April 2nd, 2019, there was approval given by the board to to enter a contract, energy saving contract with ABM Building Solutions LLC. On July 1st, 2021, the performance period for 1 year began. Year one results and measurements and verification, M&V, was the methodology and activities and observations were to be discussed, but due to the pandemic and other issues, we were behind schedule. But we're now ready to make that presentation. So Mr. Rasmussen, our Director of Maintenance and former Energy Manager, will take over the presentation at this time.
Good evening and thank you for having us. Brian Walker is at...
Push the button and turn your mic on, please. Perfect.
There we go.
Good evening and thank you for having us.
It's on.
Okay, I can let go.
Yep.
haven't used this device before. Thank you for having us. Brian Walker is going to do the majority of the presentation. We're super excited about the results that we've received from this project. It kicked off, as you mentioned, in 2019 after a couple of years worth of development. But we're now seeing the results and the fruit of the labor. So at this time, I am going to turn it over to Mr. Walker to continue with the presentation.
Good deal. Good evening, and thank you all for allowing us to come and report these results out to your board. I think we had a very good project here. My name is Brian Walker. I'm the Measurement and Verification Manager for ABM, and it is basically my job to ensure that this project remains on track and that we provide good service to you and your constituents. A very quick summary of this project. Of course, Mr. Rasmussen mentioned that we started back in 2019, and we had almost 2 year construction period, and the performance period that we will be reviewing will be from July 2021 to June of 2022. And so we initiated 12 ECMs, or energy conservation measures, here. And for year one, we report out both the installation period savings and the year one savings. As you can see here, we had a guarantee energy savings of $1.11 million that we were aiming for. And I'm happy to report out that with install savings and the year one savings, we saved $2.1 million on that. So I think that was a very good result there. I know this is a bit of an eye chart, so I'll just briefly highlight that the majority of the savings came from lighting upgrades, water conservation, the turf fields in terms of savings and operations from the conversion, and then also correcting power factor to prevent excessive charges. Next slide. And so very quickly, in terms of our methodology here, we essentially measured the energy conservation measures before and after we did the retrofits. So for example, on lighting, we know how long that the rooms typically run. So all we had to do was measure the lighting power before and after, and that would give us our savings there. We wanted to just primarily focus on what the project impacted on this. And so in terms of our ongoing M&V activities, I will be responsible for monitoring these measures. I will be, in conjunction with Mr. Rasmussen, basically monitoring any readings such as makeup water, utility bills, controls, et cetera, to make sure that we remain on track for our savings. And then finally, we did indeed run into a few issues that were able to be rectified, certainly with the help of the Goose Creek personnel. And so without delving too far into this, this is a good report essentially saying that we have corrected many of the issues we initially encountered, and we've gotten a lot more training from the various vendors, and everyone has a good handle on what is needed to maintain all of those savings. And this final slide is just a greenhouse gas equivalent slide in terms of offsets of things such as CO2, et cetera, that are directly tied out from you not using the electricity and natural gas that you would have used had you not done the project. And with that, I will take any questions.
Brian, I don't know if this is a question for you or Mr. Rasmussen, but in the negotiation to get reduced expenditures, specifically with water. I saw we had a pretty good piece of the pie there. We had savings. I know it incorporates all of Goose Creek CISD boundaries, meaning we have multiple water providers. Have we gone to that? Have we negotiated with those providers, those various providers, as a part of this? Or is that separate and apart from this project?
It is separate, and there's really no negotiation, to my knowledge, in regards to water rates that's set by whoever the provider is. And we're basically, what we try to do internally is control any waste. So we track for any leaks and try to get those addressed as quickly as possible. Where some of the water conservation was low flow restriction devices that we put in. We put in some foot pedals in the kitchens so that they don't just turn the water handles on and leave it running. They now can control it with their foot. So if their foot's on the pedal, the water's running, and if they take their foot off the pedal, the water no longer runs. So we save a lot of water in that. The biggest savings was probably in irrigation. So we put in 9 turf fields, and the irrigation responsibility is dropped significantly because of that. Is that it?
That answers my question perfectly.
Great.
Jamie, did you have anything to contribute?
I don't know. Any other questions? We're on target for year one. We're happy.
Is it a 10-year review? How many years?
We selected 5.
Okay.
And I'll just note that obviously year two will end at the end of this month. That report should be ready sometime in August.
Okay. Anyone else? Could we go back to slide 7 for a second?
With all the verbiage on it?
Here, right, that one. That's fine. I've got it here on the screen. On sports field lighting and building envelopes, there's observations but with no recommendations. Can you help me understand that?
On sports field lighting?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we haven't had any issues with failures.
Okay.
Up to the report time.
Okay, all right. And so the weather stripping being torn away from walls is just an internal thing? Okay. All right. And then no observed reported changes on HVAC, et cetera. There's just been, we're good. There's no recommendations, or you've made recommendations and we haven't gotten to it yet.
I would say we're good on year one.
Okay.
Any observations?
Sure.
On year two, we will certainly report out on.
Okay, perfect. All right. I just wanted to make sure I was not over-interpreting what was here.
If I could add to
sure.
The part about the HVAC. So when we did the initial installation with the controls, we did reveal a number of discrepancies within our systems because we now had vision into it, which we didn't before.
Right.
What we were able to do, because there was some residual money left in the package, we actually used that money to make all of the corrections that were noted during that time. So we made a lot of those repairs.
Okay. So this page is just a short time period, not our whole contract. Okay, cool. All right, got it. All right, thank you. Anyone else? All right, thank you very much.
What is 1.2 to 2.6?
Yeah, that's
2.1.
Yeah.
That sounded pretty good.
We like it. Keep it up. We every penny counts now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank y'all.
We're going to take an intermission. I don't know what y'all are doing. No, I'm just kidding. The next superintendent's report will be the academic preliminary review and legislative impact so far.
And I think if you would make these graphs a little bit smaller, you could get a lot more data on them. Sarcasm intended.
Okay. Good afternoon, President Clem, board members, and Dr. O'Brien. You have 2 slides that are on this presentation that was not in the original one, and I know that's, y'all look at me crazy if I do that. It's because we received the state averages for those EOC courses and the district today.
Okay.
So I wanted you to have the most up-to-date.
I need to watch yours and not what's in my packet.
No, you're right. So this first slide here.
Okay.
Oh, did you update it? Thank you, Naomi. You're fast. So this was updated today, and it is how we performed against the state and the region. So very important, I think, that we have this information. So for English 1, and I didn't introduce myself for the audience here. I'm Susan Jackson, director, deputy suit for CNI.
James Husband, district data specialist.
I get excited over data, and I jump in here. So for English 1, the district performed at 67% for approaches, and you can see we are running shortly behind the state and the region in those areas, all areas of approaches, meets, and masters. And for English 2, in the same boat. So we know we have some work there to do. For Algebra 1, however, we were leading the state in all areas in the region, so that's exciting. Biology, we're within 1 point above or at, so we're really right in the mix, so that's good news there. And for U.S. history, the same thing. It's nice to see that everybody performed as well as they did at 95 and 94% pass rate. So the original information you got starts here, and I wanted to make sure you had those first slides because now you can actually compare the campuses that performed above or below the state averages. And we will get that to you in a better format. We were just trying to make sure we got it to you today since it came out. So you can see the district performed and the campuses that performed above the district average and the ones that performed below the district average. I will say that you might want to keep in mind that for Peter Highlands, it was a very few group, and for the academy, virtual academy, you're talking about less than 10 kids. And then also for Point, small group of people. English 2, the district average is there, and you can see the schools that performed above, the ones that performed below, and you can see if there's a significant gap there. Algebra 1, you can see the two that performed above. The district set at 83. We had two campuses performed, but you can also see the ones that were below were right in line. Biology is the same. You can see that that most of our campuses as well performed above the district average and the state average for that biology. And then U.S. history at 94%, and you can see that we really had only one campus that even scored below, and that was 93%, so really excited about those. So the preliminary data tells us that we need to really, really focus on ELA. And I'm going to move it to Mr. Husband to go over the new, y'all have heard us talk about 4545, now it's going to be referred to as House Bill 1416.
So 4545 has been amended. 4545 came out in the 87th legislature in 2021. HB 1416 was just signed into law by Governor Abbott on June the 9th of this year, and it goes into effect immediately. The changes, it does eliminate the Accelerated Learning Committee meetings. Those were previously required for all 5th and 8th grade students who did not score at approaches or above. It removes the STAR Alt 2 from the HB 4545 requirements. It reduces the hours from 30 hours of accelerated instruction to 15 hours unless the student performs significantly below satisfactorily. Now, where we're at is the governor has not designated yet what it constitutes significantly below satisfactorily, so that's still forthcoming. And then it increases the student-to-teacher ratio from 3 to 1 to 4 to 1.
No. We still need 4,000 more tutors.
Yes. School districts are not required to provide supplemental instruction for more than two subject areas. So if a student does not meet requirements in more than two areas, the district shall prioritize RLA and math.
And so that would make it go back up to 30 hours instead of 15.
Right. So 15 for each. Right.
Yes.
Are they footing the bill?
No.
We know about unfunded mandates.
A parent may elect to modify or remove the requirement, but the district cannot encourage them or direct the parent to do so. If they fail the same subject for more than two consecutive years, we have to make a good faith effort to provide that student's parent or guardian with a parent-teacher conference. That replaces the Accelerated Learning Committee. If they failed for the same subject for two or more years, we have to have an accelerated education plan, so that's discussed during that parent-teacher meeting. We have to identify the reason for that, and we must give them 30 hours of supplemental instruction. We can expand the times. What that means is that you can do it before or after school, or alternative, instead of just in the school day.
Now, I will say on this one, if I failed two subjects and one of them was for 2 years in a row, I have 30 hours for the 2 years in a row and then 15 for that other one.
Yes.
If I failed two years in a row, then it's back up to 60 hours.
Right. And if there's any student that's receiving special education services, the student's art committee shall review and they will determine the participation or the progress in that instruction. Guys have any questions?
Any chance any of this is going to change? I know it was signed already, but will it be amended along the way?
I don't know.
Any talk about that?
Amended? Yeah.
Well, yeah. But is somebody going to come and change it during special session after we make our plans?
He's basically said, I'm lightening up, and that's his version of
it. Okay. All right. Right.
The elementary grades in junior
high. Right. Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it. All right, we will now move to action items. 8A is consideration of adoption of the 2023-24 proposed budgets for the general fund, debt service fund, and child nutrition fund. I would seek a motion.
I'll make a motion to adopt the 2023-24 proposed budget for the general fund and child nutrition funds and debt services.
Okay. Second. I have a motion from Ms. Brott-Tim and a second from Mr. Renteria to approve the proposed budgets for the general fund, debt service fund, and child nutrition fund. Is there any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. I see 5 votes for, 0 against, 2 absent. The motion passes. Moving to the consideration of consent agenda, Dr. O'Brien.
Yes, administration brings before the board 11 consent agenda items, one of them being a donation, number B1, donation from Lockwood Andrews and Noonan, Inc., that's LAN, who will be providing the back-to-school Giant Con t-shirts. Yay. Number 2, proposed staff development minutes waiver for the 23-24 school year. Number 3, board policy CDA local, other revenues and investments. Number 4, resolution for the school district's approved sources of instruction relating to investment responsibilities. Number 5, list of qualified brokers, dealers, and financial institutions for the 23-24 school year. Number 6, competitive seal proposals, or CSPs, as the delivery method for the Technology Center expansion project. Number 7, competitive seal proposals, CSP, as the delivery method for the Stallworth Stadium Fieldhouse project. Number 8, purchasing cooperative interlocal agreement with Omnia Partners. Number 9, delinquent tax attorneys contract, Reed, Strickland, and Gillette, LLP. Number 10, TREA, Texas Rural Educator Association Legal Services Program Agreement, with Powell Law Group, LLP, for the 23-24 school year. Number 11, budget amendments as presented.
Would anyone like to pull an item or ask a clarifying question? All right, I would like to ask about the staff development waiver, and I'm sure you can take it from there. Just remind me, I read chapter 25.081, and it made about as much sense as one of those graphic novels do.
So this is the waiver that we do every year for professional
dates. That's our PLC dates on the calendar.
Yes.
Thank you. I just couldn't pull that out of the air. Anyone else? Then I would seek a motion concerning the consent agenda as presented. I'll second that. So we have a motion from Mr. Renteria and a second from myself to approve the consent agenda as presented. Any further discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Have 5 votes for, 0 against, 2 absent. Motion passes. Future board agenda items. Or board trainings. SLI was awesome for those of you who got to go.
We have TexCon coming up in September.
TexCon in September. That's in Dallas this year. And I think we changed meetings that we needed to change last meeting, so we should be good on meetings, unless anybody needs a special one. All right, with that said, we're trying to set a world record for a regular board meeting time.
The next board meeting?
July 10th. Yeah, the next regular board meeting is July 10th. All right. Almost have this memorized, but not quite. All right, this board will now recess into a closed session pursuant to the following sections of the Texas Open Meeting Act, Texas Government Code sections 551.071, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 082, 83, 84, and 087. No action will be taken while the board is in closed meeting. The time is 6:44 p.m. Being into open session, no decisions were made while the board was in closed session, and the time is 9:02 p.m. We're on agenda item 8F, consideration of personnel. Dr. O'Brien?
Yes, administration would recommend that the board accept resignations and retirements and approve teacher elections as presented.
Point of order, we gave you the authority to do that on your own during the months of June and July.
Very good. Were there any outside of that, Noemi?
No.
Those are all within that. Thank you very much. So then I would bring before you the administrative elections. Thank you. For ARD facilitators, HR brings to the board this evening Brittany Duncan and Megan LaCour.
I move to approve the ARD facilitators as presented.
Second.
Have a motion from Mr. Campisi.
Yes, sir.
And a second from Mrs. Barat-Timms to approve the ARD facilitators as presented. Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. Seeing 5-4, 0 against, 2 absent, motion passes.
Bring to the board, approve the selection of instructional specialist for mathematics, Ricky Edwards.
I move to approve.
My second. Have a motion from Mrs. Barat-Timms and a second from myself to approve the instructional specialist in mathematics. Any discussion? All in favor, please raise your hand. See 5-4, 0 against, 2 absent, motion passes.
And bring before you the literacy coach specialist, Rashida Villard Frank.
Move to approve the literacy coach specialist.
Second.
I have a motion from Ms. Barat-Timms and a second from Mr. Campisi to approve literacy coach specialist as presented. Discussion? All in favor? All in favor?
Oh.
Seeing 5-4, 0 against, motion passes.
Selection of student support administrators, Deanna Masalis, Anthony Moore. That's it.
Move to approve the student support administrators as presented.
I'll second.
Have a motion from Mrs. Barat-Timms and a second from Mr. Campisi to approve SSAs as presented. Discussion? All in favor? 5-4, 0 against, motion passes.
Bring before you elementary assistant principals, Adrian Alarcon and Dolores Serrano.
Move to approve the elementary assistant principals as presented.
I'll second.
A motion from Mrs. Barat-Timms and a second from Mr. Campisi to approve elementary assistant principals. Discussion? All in favor? 5-4, 0 against, motion passes.
Bring before the board for approval the selection of a junior school assistant principal, Michael Previte.
Move to approve junior school assistant principal Michael Previte as presented.
Second.
A motion from Ms. Brott-Timms and a second from Mr. Campisi to approve junior school assistant principal. Discussion? Sorry, that got my attention. All in favor, raise your hand. 5-0 against, motion passes.
And then finally, we bring before the board for consideration the principal of EF Green Junior High, Dr. Alicia Babin.
Go ahead.
Move to approve junior school principal as presented.
And I'll second it.
A motion from Ms. Brott-Timms and a gracious second from Mr. Campisi to approve junior school principal. Discussion? All in favor? I see 5-4-0 against, motion passes. Agenda item 9, consideration of bids for the purchase of property.
Administration recommends to reject sealed bids at this point in time.
I would seek a motion to approve the administration's request to reject the bids.
I'll move to reject that bid.
And I have a motion from Mr. Campisi and a second from Mrs. Brott-Timms to reject the bids that were presented for purchase of property. Any further discussion? All in favor? 5-4-0 against, motion passes. And with that, the time is 9:07 and we are adjourned.